Thank you all, and welcome to the first panel of Caux Dialogue on Environment and Security. It's a great pleasure to have you all with our moderators and speakers and our wonderful guests and participants. So welcome, and we are pleased to host you on behalf of Initiatives of Change Switzerland, who are celebrating 75th anniversary this year at Caux. Caux Palace is where we would normally run our event. And we are very happy to see you online here. But if you're around Caux Palace, please visit. And if you want to subscribe to Initiatives of Change mailing list, you can learn more about 75th anniversary events. We are here kicking off our Caux Dialogue on Environment and Security, Remaking a World in Peril, Forging Collaborations for a Secure and Sustainable Future. We know that we urgently need solutions, and we know that land degradation and environmental degradation leads to conflict, but we are looking for ways to build peace and promote cross-cultural dialogue and collaboration through environmental restoration. And we are very happy to start this day with a very topical conversation on single-use plastic. Today we have the members of the BARTS on the call. It's a network of artists that want to use the different art forms to help bridge the gap between information and action, and to provide emotional connection, inspiration, and motivation to face the challenges related to the climate disaster. They will be listening, and they will be responding to the content that we are producing in their own unique way, in a method that they call prisming. The results will be presented in our newsletters, so stay tuned for the artistic outcome of this event. And we are starting the panel, so without further delay, I am passing the floor to Sofia Sidorenko, representative of Zero Waste Alliance Ukraine and the Foundations for Freedom. Thank you, Sofia. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Irina, for this kind introduction, and thank you so much, everyone, for being here. My name is Sofia. I will be moderating our session today, and as Irina said, I am the representative from Zero Waste Alliance Ukraine, which is the alliance of three organizations in Ukraine that work on waste prevention in Ukraine. And I'm also the representative of Foundations for Freedom, which is the member and a part of Initiatives of Change Network. So today, I am very, very prepared. So if you see me looking downstairs, don't think that I'm looking for someone. I'm just looking into my notes. It is a big, big pleasure that you're here today. And today's conversation is dedicated to the topic of overconsumption with the emphasis on single-use plastics. Probably the biggest question that strikes me the most today is how normal it becomes for us to follow this path, extract resources, make something out of them that we are using for a very short period of time, and then easily throw it away. There are many myths around this topic still. For instance, that recycling, just simply recycling, will solve the problem. But unfortunately, or luckily, it's not true, because we need to work on solving the problem at the beginning, at the very source of the problem, and not in the middle of the way or at the end of the way. There is another myth that you might have experienced recently, and it's actually connected with COVID-19. I don't know what is the situation in your countries, but for instance, in Ukraine, when the quarantine started, most of the foods in supermarkets, markets, and everywhere was packaged in single-use plastics with the note that it's going to protect us from virus spreading, without any data, without any scientific proof that it's actually going to protect us. So there is still a lot of myths that we need to bust, but I definitely can tell for sure that the tables are turning around. And do you know who is behind this table turning process? You don't have to answer in the chat. It's actually us. It's all of us. And every single of us has power to bring change without any doubt. And today, I am actually very much happy to say that we have an opportunity to hear three transformational stories from three amazing speakers who are now working in this field and who have come to the understanding that the change needed to happen and then that they have strength to bring this change. So please meet. The first speaker is Justine Maillot. She is the consumption and production campaigner and policy coordinator of Rethink Plastic Alliance. Justine, if we were in Caux, you would get applause. So you did. The next speaker is Jack McKibben. He is the Zero Waste Cities Program Coordinator at Zero Waste Europe. And last but not the least is Anna Ponikarchuk, who is the co-founder of the first zero waste shop in Ukraine called Ozero. So the structure of our session today is the following. We will have 1 hour and a half, and the first part of our session will be divided into three parts of 15 minutes each per each speaker. And during these parts, we will hear the stories of the speakers. Then we will have a few minutes of quiet time to digest everything what we've heard, think about what we've heard and get ready for next part. And the last part will be 20 minute breakout rooms in which we will have an opportunity to have deeper conversations with each of the speakers. So we will have three breakout rooms with each speaker in each room, and you will be able to decide which room you want to attend. And then afterwards, we will all come back and have final thoughts and suggestions and finish up and go change the world. So this is the plan for today. Very simple, not a problem at all. And I actually really like this thing without further, no, I'm not gonna say that. Please welcome our first speaker, Justine, who will tell us her personal beautiful story and hopefully we'll be eager to hear that.
Thank you very much, Sophia, and good afternoon, good morning maybe to all of you. It's nice to see you all over here. I'm gonna share my screen, nothing very elaborate, but I just thought sometimes a few pictures are quite nice, so I'm just gonna put that in full screen. So as Sophia said, I work for the Rethink Plastic Alliance, which is basically an alliance of non-governmental organization, NGOs working mainly on EU policies related to plastic. So basically we work together to create policy change because we think that there's a big role to be played by our decision makers and regulatory bodies to really set a number of rules that really drive change, that prevent plastic pollution, that ensure that the products that are put on the market are sustainable, etc. So that's the role of the Alliance. We're part of a bigger movement that is called the Break Free from Plastic Movement, to which the Zero Waste Europe, Zero Waste Alliance Ukraine is also part of. So I know Sophia quite well. And basically this movement altogether actually acts you know, across the globe and really trying to bring change through different ways. And you will hear about Jack and Zero Waste Cities data, but the way I try to contribute and the Alliance try to contribute is through policy change, basically. And usually I'm here to talk about technical policy demands and recommendations, but today is a bit different because I've been asked to share a bit more about my personal experience and where maybe what I do or yeah, where it comes from, why I decided to dedicate quite a lot of my time to the work I'm doing now. So I actually try to think back a little bit. I'm French. I grew up in the suburbs of Paris, so kind of in a bit of a weird mix where it's not exactly the city, but you're also a bit disconnected from nature, I would say, in general. So a little bit of a big mix. And just I can say already from where I was born 30 years ago to now, the landscape even of the Parisian suburbs have changed a lot. It used to be fields, now it's huge malls every 15 kilometers, etc. So already seeing this is quite interesting. And when I thought about sustainable consumption and waste, trying to think where it may have started, I think it actually started with food and food waste. So I don't know if it's because, you know, as a French, I'm a bit of a foodie, but in any case, I remember arguing, I should say, with my mom, which, you know, who I love deeply, but I was really arguing with her about food waste when I was a teenager. And I think it really started from there, looking at, you know, where the foods we were eating were coming from, and also feeling really overwhelmed where we would throw away foods, or, you know, when it would go badly or meant to go badly because there was a date on the packaging, which didn't necessarily make a lot of sense. And so I think it really came from there. It also came very much from the environmental perspective, but I think very much from the social angle as well, because I was lucky enough to be born in a kind of middle-class family, but, you know, everybody is not raised the same way and doesn't have the same chance to start with. So I think it really struck me then. And then, I mean, I went into, so in terms of waste, I would say, I think that was my main approach to it. When I was a teenager, I think, sorry about this. I think really we were obviously recycling as a teenager, et cetera, when I was a teenager, but I don't think I really realized then and really questioned where the rest was going. Well, should definitely have. So yeah, I think it really came from there, from what I remember. And then I went into law school. So I did study law, mainly related to human rights and environmental protection. And quite a few years later, I ended up in Brussels working on EU policies on overfishing. And I think that was the next step on my journey on sustainable consumption, or rather unsustainable consumption in that case. I worked for 6 years with the EU unit of Greenpeace in Brussels, working on policies related to fishing and basically aiming at ending overfishing, making sure that EU legislation on fishing would prevent overfishing, would set really strong quotas in line with the science, et cetera, et cetera. And you may know that or not, but there's also, there used to be a very kind of damaging practices in fisheries, which was a lot of fish was thrown overboard. It was called discarding. So you would discard fish that you had caught. So it was, dead or very much injured, and you would still, fishermen would still throw it back at sea. Because it was not the fish they wanted to target, or because it was over the quota, etc. And so you would have all this wasted fish. So there was a problem, obviously, overconsumption of fish, but also, you know, just wasting it, because in a way it's just going dead to the ocean and no one is even gonna eat it anyway. And so I think that was also very much part of my world for quite a long time. And also getting into the waste issue a bit. And when I worked on fisheries, I also started to realize also the impact of European consumption habits on the rest of the world, because there's a lot of agreements between EU fishing vessels and some African countries or Asian country, for example. And then there's a lot of competition with local fishermen in those countries that actually need fish for their protein intake, while in Europe we may have many other sources. So it actually led me to decide to go a bit more on the ground after having worked in Brussels for like 4 or 5 years. And so I decided to go travel a bit and join a number of projects on the ground. And I think that's actually where starting to work more on fisheries, I ended up knowing much more about waste management. And the first stop was actually in Madagascar. So I spent a few months working for an NGO there. So in the north west of Madagascar, small village in the middle of the mangroves, absolutely beautiful. but also realizing there that some of the same brands were sold. Most of the food, I would say, was very local, but still you had like one supermarket in the city, and you would find the same product as you would find in Europe, basically. But there was no producer responsibility. There was no obligation for the brands to then treat their waste. So the situation was that luckily we were producing very little waste in terms of packaging, mainly, but still the very little we were producing, there was nothing we could do with it. And so you had to end up adding it to a landfill somewhere or burning it yourself in your garden. And you know, burning it is never a good idea. But I think that was the first time I was really faced with like, okay, I have no other option. And being born in Europe, it was, or in France, it was easier. I would just, you know, put it in a bin bag and someone else would take care of it. And it was the first time I really had to take care of it myself. And there was really no good solution. So I think for me, that was really eye-opening. And a few months later, I was super lucky to go to Nepal. And I think there it went to the next level. So this is actually a picture I really love. I spent like 3 months there, and in the morning on this bridge, you would have the ships going for the day because they would go somewhere, and then on the way back in every evening, it was like one of my favorite moments of the day. And the reason why there's a bridge is that under it, there was a river, and we would use that river to basically bath, wash clothes, also enjoy and just have a swim. It was a beautiful river. And there as well, what I discovered was sachets, which was for me very new. So they look like this, basically. There's those individual wrappers for like a dose of shampoo or for, you know, crisp or snacks or sweets. And they are very, very popular, and they're becoming even more popular in a lot of countries around the globe, especially in Asia. And here, so they're sold individually because then the price per unit is lower. But of course, if you actually compare the price, it's actually much more expensive than if you were buy it in a much bigger proportion, for example. And again, you end up with those plastic packaging that, you know, there's no infrastructure to take care of. They're very light. So they would just end up in the river or in the forest nearby, just very, very commonly. And they would also come to a certain extent into competition with like just what they used to use with local plants, etc. And you could see this trend growing. And again, it was many of the international brands, many of the European brands. And again, no responsibility at all there of the producers to make sure those sachets are going to be collected and they're going to be treated, certainly not recycled because they're not recyclable, but at least collected. And there was none of this. And obviously when it's your environment, I think for quite a long time, it becomes quite clear that, yeah, it becomes really personal and you get a bit hungry at it, and there's no way of avoiding it to a certain extent, and it's growing. And obviously it's super attractive to the young generation because, you know, they want to use the same products of other people in other countries. And it seems, or it's presented as, you know, a developed thing and, you know, a trendy thing. Well, it's just contributing to the pollution of their beautiful environment. So I think that was really, really striking. And obviously it goes back to the local versus imported as well, which was a bit, I was also struggling with, because all of those products are from European international brands and imported into the country versus using some of the local goods they may have and plants, etc. And yeah, so that's where I think waste management really became much more aware of it. And then I continued to travel a bit. I was really lucky in that sense. And then I was always quite paying attention to that. And it was very clear. Sophia, loud and clear. It was clear that it was an issue in most places. And then I came back to Europe, and weirdly, it circled back a little bit, because when I came back to Europe, I actually started working for an organization called Surfrider, who's working on plastic pollution a lot. And then I joined Zero Waste Europe a few years later. And that was at that time, actually, that there was a trial in France where I was born about the impact of an incinerator in the town I was born, I was raised, I was going to school with. And then there were many cases of deaths, and there was a full trial, and the incinerator had to be stopped, etc. But it bring me back to the fact that I was not really paying attention to what, you know, where the waste was going when I was a teenager, but the reality was it was actually going there, just producing toxins, and you know, impacting, including the communities I was growing with, etc. So yeah, I think it brought me back to back to Europe, and also the end of life to a certain extent, but really also showing that, you know, you really need to think about how you first design your products and when you put them on the market, and make sure they're sustainable from the start, or they will just end up in an incinerator with the consequences we know. And I think what was also clear for me is that I really enjoy doing a lot of groundwork projects, and really contributing to very local projects. But considering my background in law and in policy, I felt like actually my contribution was maybe to try to continue driving change at the EU level. And that's why when I came back, I decided to join an NGO again and then join the Alliance, because I felt, well, maybe that's where I'm the most useful. And I'll be happy to discuss more of the policy work with you all in the breakout if you want. And I'll leave it to that. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Justine. Yes, and thank you so much for your questions in chat. You will have an opportunity to discuss them further in breakout rooms. Thank you so much, Justine, again. And now I would like to welcome Jack McKibben, who is the Zero Waste Cities Program Coordinator at Zero Waste Europe. Jack, please come to the stand. And if you see me at the end showing this strange thing, it means that it's 2 minutes left. Yeah. Thank you.
It's pretty self-explanatory. I love it. But Sophia, thank you. Yeah, thank you all for the invitation to join today. It's a pleasure. And it's sort of a very much, I feel like it's similar to Justine in terms of often speak about the topic, but when you ask the personal journey, it's a bit like, well, that's a harder discussion or a topic to think about. And in particular, I don't think my journey is extraordinary in any sense. It's very ordinary, but I will share some thoughts, I'll share some photos to help guide the presentation, and I'm going to set my clock for 14 minutes now, so avoid that, Sophia, hopefully. All right, so yeah, my name is Jack McQuiven. I'm the Zero Waste Cities Program Coordinator at Zero Waste Europe. A quick sort of note about Zero Waste Europe: we're a Brussels-based NGO, but we have 31 members in 27 European countries, inside and outside the European Union. And it includes things like the organizations like the wonderful Zero Waste Alliance in Ukraine. And our role is sort of to use our position in Brussels to campaign for effective and ambitious waste legislation at the European Union level, to support this at the national level. But a large part of my role in particular in the city's work is that we support and mentor local groups and local authorities to help design and implement effective zero waste strategies in their communities. I can talk about that more at the end if there's time, or certainly in the breakout rooms, but for now, a bit more about the personal journey aspects. So yeah, I'm 29 years old. If you couldn't have noticed already, I'm British, but living in Brussels, made the move pre-Brexit or post-vote, pre-formalisation, I suppose. And I've been a Zero Waste Europe for over 2 years in this current role, but have, a couple of years of experience working for different NGOs in the fields of youth-led development, sustainability, and one interesting year straight out of university working in global reinsurance in the City of London, which was eye-opening for sure. A large part of my journey, I would say, is sort of, I love being outdoors now, running, cycling, anything really. That's ironically not based behind a desk, I suppose, is where you'll find me most happy. Okay, so responsible consumption plastics and me, where to begin. So Justine's presentation was very formal, professional. It's very Justine, it's fantastic. Whereas I feel one a bit embarrassed already. This is setting the tone in terms of there I am as a wee child. But I grew up in a sort of a small town in Essex, which is east of London, as you see here. It's a kind of place, sort of a population of about 30,000 commutes. Most people, most workers will commute into London for various jobs. It's the kind of place where most people know most people, really, and it voted heavily for Brexit as well. So, just to set the scene in the context of where I grew up. But continuing on with this unprofessional theme that's going on with these photos, I guess, yeah, I just wanted to say, as in a very ordinary story. I never grew up with sort of politics or particularly the environment, never played a huge role as I grew up as a child. I never, until I sort of got into my teenage years, I never thought about consumption or climate change or any of these issues and didn't have to deal with politics because I lived a very privileged life in terms of, being a male, white, British, and reasonably middle class as well. So that is just interesting, I think. Potentially interesting. It's not going to come as a shock, but when you're sort of going through school and as I begin to work into college years, so that's turning 15, 16, reading the sort of planted the seed of interest in these topics. And it wasn't just environmentalism, it was the wider world. And I think, why do we sort of have the injustices that we have in particular? What is the role of the UK? I think that was particularly interesting for me. And you understand that in our education system here, we don't learn about colonialism or historical injustices or the fact that, our relationship with fossil fuels, all of these things, but you have to read and learn yourself. And so in particular, this book by John Pilcher, Freedom Next Time, sort of opened my eyes to the wider world, the injustices, but there are numerous others. It's actually quite a recent photo. So there's some that weren't around when I was 16, but you get the gist in terms of, I think for most people, I would say it's reading sort of planted the seed of interest in, what is this wider world that's happening out there? Why are people suffering like they are? What is the cause of this? And what are the solutions? Most important. Very similar to Justine. It's ironic, I guess, global travel helped create us, or certainly myself, in interesting campaigning for environmentalism. So it takes, traveling around the other side of the world on a fuel emitting plane to have this, but it cannot be underestimated the impact it had on me as a person, simply because I sort of spent 3 months working with local groups in India. The topic was on sort of health and prevention, but there was a lot to do in terms of the local environment. And I think it had a huge impact on me in two different ways. Firstly, it's very cliche, but you meet people, for me at least, with less than what we had in the UK, but yet so much more contentness, so much more to give, so much more joy and happiness. And that I really sort of had an impact on me on why aren't we more grateful? Why aren't we more community focused? And so bringing those sort of values and learning back with me and applying them in my own work, sort of life was huge. And then the second sort of impact was just seeing what a lack of waste management infrastructure does for a beautiful, beautiful country or the countryside and sort of, where it's not the fault of individuals. Just Justine saying, people who are forced to buy sachets or is there any option and therefore I don't have any sort of solid disposal methods or at least recycling, reuse, all of this stuff was simply non-existent back in 2012, 2013 in sort of Southeast India and Tamil Nadu. And then of course, the year before that, I also spent 2 months in Indonesia and Bali. That had less of a profound impact. That was amazing experience, but I was the cliche wasted tourist in that sense, in terms of most of my time was focused on education and a bit of beach time and surfing. So moving swiftly on, the time in India, I think, really helped, as I said, lay the foundation and sort of water the seed that had been planted in the books that I've read in terms of, we can't continue on like this. I think that was simply that. And it's something that I've seen so much more better communicated or visualized in recent years, but it's what I was struggling with at the time is that why don't more people not care? We are, the evidence in the science says that we're, you know, becoming the first species ever to be aware about self extinction, and yet we seemingly do nothing about it. And I can quite get my head around that in a sense. And so I sort of wanted to really act upon it, to question, and I found a job working for an NGO called CEST Development that really helped. It was all about youth-led development, and it focused my role building networks in the UK, so supporting other young people to take action, to create their own local campaigns, not just on climate change, but for other issues. And again, I can't underestimate the importance this played for me in terms of showcasing that we as young people had a meaningful voice, and so often we're excluded from the discussions for various reasons. But you know, we have a voice and a calling, whatever ways you want to bring it to the world. But that's finding that and aligning your values with that cause is one of the most important things that we can do, and we should reflect upon and try to identify. So yeah, being able to use all that cheesy stuff in the day-to-day work to help inspire, to train, to build capacity, to campaign, to speak with decision makers, all of these things meant that I could really sort of not only hit the streets campaigning, but also in the workplace be quite an annoying person who reminds people to turn switches off, turn their laptops off, don't boil too much water in a kettle, et cetera, et cetera. And then, yeah, my work sort of took on a more global focus. In 2015, saw the adoption of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, informally known as the Global Goals. And they sort of followed the Millennium Development Goals, which was purely focused on developing countries. But this was much more on, it applied to all 192 UN member states. And it really sort of set a framework that I thought, okay, this is something to be excited about and hopeful for. And you'll see here, in particular, my work was beginning to focus on responsible consumption and production and the means of which that we as individuals can help save the planet, and therefore humans as well, but then the broader societal and systemic issues that are affecting it. It's not just down to the individual, as Justine was saying, to choose a sustainable option. It's the stuff that happens way miles and miles and sort of days before this to decide it's only sachets that people can buy. You know, it's the production methods as well behind this. So aligning those two ideas and methodologies with this global framework was super helpful for me, and also aligned with the next step in my career, where I took my skills and we're still with the same organization, but took them on a global level and started to support global networks of young people, not only in Europe, but in the United States. Europe, the United Kingdom, but also Africa and Asian countries as well. And again, I think it just meeting with youth activists and sort of working with them, inspiring, bringing people together, taking their voices to power, sort of telling truth to power, enforce this. And this is something that I fully believe and I'm so grateful for, because I wouldn't have really understood the true value of before. It's this, the impact that we can have as individuals, as a single voice, but also collectively. Together, and I think that's huge, particularly when you harness diversity as well. And so these experiences, these sort of learnings that I gained via my time at CEST Development really helped sort of along my journey. So I was spending a lot of time at the United Nations, focusing on the global goals there, and sort of got a sense of, once the novelty wears off about, oh my gosh, this is important rooms, blah, 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 you understand the frustrations and the politicalness of these spaces, these discussions, and how slow, how bureaucratic things are. So I started to get a bit more frustrated, particularly on the environmental angle. And if anyone wants to sort of see how mass consumption looks like, they could spend some time in the US. It's a lovely country, don't get me wrong. I very much enjoy any time there. But any sort of item that you buy comes in most layers of packaging in most cities. I'm a bit gross sort of oversimplifying things there, but that also sort of helps sow the seeds in terms of why I don't need 5 napkins or a plastic bag or plastic cutlery with this one small item. And so I was lucky enough to continue sort of development in my career. And I really sort of, I think, I can't recommend this enough for anyone, but like just in your free time or in your work, embed like continued learning. And I sort of wasn't just reading books, but there was like a ton of new podcasts that really opened my eyes, and I go into events and meeting new people and being inspired. And sort of for me, I have had a role that focused on sustainability now in a different NGO that took me to spaces like the UN Environment Assembly. I was beginning to work in the UK about how to change consumption methods to focus more on health, obviously, yeah, environmental reasons, but really sort of harnessing that individual sort of responsible consumption idea. And again, it was an eye-opening experience because being based in the UK, there's a lot of negative stuff. It's a very easy way to stay in terms of plastic, how easy it is to find single-use items everywhere you go. I was living and working in London at this time, and you could find your sort of zero waste bubble in terms of the shop that you would go to, the food that you would buy, the people that you hang around with. But then I struggled with any time you go outside of the big city, and you see that, you know, it's still ingrained, the use of plastic bags, the use of single-use items on every day, on every sort of day items, fruit, vegetables, toys. There was mass consumption everywhere, and I struggled to sort of grapple with that, I think. And I just wanted to include this chart on the left because, it shows that the number of sort of plastic bags that were found on beaches really dropped in the UK. And this came into a 5p charge, so like a 5 cent charge based on the use of plastic bags, and really helped drop. And I thought, gosh, people are going shopping for like spending 30, 40, 50 pounds worth, euros worth, and yet they're not not spending 5p on a plastic bag. And it wasn't much at all. So, you know, how can we therefore like harness and utilize that, like small things? Like, and so did some research on nudging and behavioral sort of psychology, all of these sort of interesting things to get people to change without feeling that they have to or being told to, which I think is increasingly important. And this is what has brought me very fortunately to Zero Waste Europe, into my role now, where I sort of combine my passion for environmentalism with building networks and advocacy to get to spread the message about what zero waste is for local municipalities. How can we create systems that simply don't generate waste in the first place, in particular sort of plastics as well? And you get to meet wonderful activists like Sophia and her team, and you get invited to cool events like this as well. So I will stop there. I think I'm under 15 minutes, maybe just a little bit over, so sorry, Sophia. I hope the journey it's been an awkward 14 minutes for me, but I hope it's been resonated with you, or at least helped frame the discussion a bit more. So thank you again for this opportunity, and I look forward to hearing Anna speak and then the breakout discussions after.
Thank you so much, Jack, for so many beautiful insights and for so many beautiful thoughts you brought to us. Thank you very much. And of course, for the beautiful pictures. I want to invite next Anna Ponikarchuk, who is the co-founder of the first Zero Waste shop in Ukraine. And I'm sure that she will also share a beautiful, beautiful story with us. Anna, go ahead.
Hello, everybody. Thank you, Sophia, for inviting me today as an expert speaking on plastics and single-use consumption session. I also have some list prepared, so I may be glimpsing there every now and then. So I'm a co-founder of a first zero waste and sustainability company in Ukraine. And my story began long time ago, as for each one of us, but I even changed it a little bit while I was listening to other two speakers, because they brought some really deep ideas into my head. And one of them was that I think Ukrainians, or more maybe generally Slavic people, they are on an everyday basis quite wise people, because Ukraine hasn't been yet introduced the idea of overconsumption. And the level of life, you know, comfort of life is growing steadily. So people don't have that much spare money to spend on things that they don't need, though this is changing slowly. As it used to be before, like in the USSR times, people just had limited amount of money and actually limited amount of resource. So I think this is one of my backgrounds. I was brought up in an average, average family, where things were taken care of, clothes and shoes were repaired, and stuff like this. And as a teenager, I got a chance to visit Germany for a month and live in an average German family. And it was the first time when the situation happened to me, like we were somewhere walking or hiking and we had water in plastic bottle and we finished it. And we Ukrainians were about to throw it away. And we're like, stop, wait, don't do that. And it was, I think like 17 years ago. And I'm like, why? What do you want to do with this bottle? And people didn't let us throw anything away because they needed to bring it back to the supermarket and use it in the vending machine, yeah, so to say, where you can get your 50 cents back. And it was completely new to me. And also recycling bins at home, like, what do I do? What do I put where? And I was not aware of the fact that something can be done in a different way compared to what it was in my own life. Then later on, I grew up, graduated from university, this and that. And then accidentally, I visited a landfill close to Kyiv, close to the capital of Ukraine, like 30 kilometers away from the city. And we went there by accident, really by chance. We weren't planning to get there because we didn't know it was there. But as I saw it, a huge pile of waste, I got shocked and I thought, oh God, my garbage is going there for all these years. So many things that I used before are probably resting there. And I did I made a choice of sending them there. I was shocked and I wanted to do things in a different way, but I had no answer to how can I do it in a different way. So I needed to start my own journey, my own research. And then this and that, I started somehow being a volunteer at different environmental organizations that existed at that point in Ukraine. There were very few. And I also became a lecturer on the recycling topic. So I was going to different schools, universities, companies, just giving lectures on how to recycle. And at some point I realized the recycling is a very important tool, but it is not the only answer. And I wanted to speak more about zero waste, about waste prevention. So then we separated from that NGO that I was volunteering for with another girl, and we started our own project on zero waste. We started giving lectures and it became quite popular because we were very honest and open-minded, and all our lectures were always like full. But then people started to ask, I agree with everything you say, but what do I do if I want to have a reusable water bottle? Where do I get it from? Or like a sustainable toothbrush, what do I do? And we understood that lectures are good, but not good enough. And we started our own small business from like online page on Facebook, where we had only two items bought on our own savings, which were a German company. We did a lot of research. We're like freaks in sustainability and quality. So we couldn't just go to like Chinese website and order whatever. Yeah. We needed to be very professional from the very beginning. That was how we did it. And we just bought two items. It was zero waste, bamboo toothbrush and cotton swabs. And it was, I believe, 2018. Yeah, January 2018. And from that time on, we just were reinvesting money. And that's what we're doing just till now. So today's story of my business is that it has three main directions. The most visible and understandable, the one you can understand, see, touch, and feel, is of course zero waste shop. We have more than 700 different positions in the shop, which we take super long time to research and choose and combine and like email or have calls with manufacturer, check certification, check working conditions of people involved, check supply chain, everything. I think being kind of zero waste nerds, we are one of the only ones in Ukraine who does it in this way. And from 2018, when we started, I see even some of our clients doing the same, but I mean, opening zero waste shops, but just with things from Chinese supermarkets, you know. So in one way, it's good because the information is spreading, but from another hand, it's not as good because they only sell cheap and non-reliable, non-sustainable options. As for zero waste shop, today we have very beautiful, very nice showroom, like brick and mortar store in the city center of Kyiv. So if you ever visit Ukraine, we'll be very happy to meet you there. And we also have a cafe where we compost waste and have no single use tableware, no single use cups or whatever. And second part, second direction is the consulting, because or zero space, what my business is called, it's not only zero waste shop, it's also business consulting, or we consult organizations or private individuals, whoever addresses us, to get help on what is sustainability, on how can they reduce their waste, on how can they change their life or their activities. So most of the time it's just people, organizations or companies addressing us, and very often it is, hi, I want to start recycling in my company. Can you help me with that? And we're like, yes, but you know, recycling is not the most important thing. So we, of course, we help people to learn how to recycle, but we see it as a very big and complicated topic, which not only involves installing recycling bins in the office and saying, tick, yeah, we did that, that's enough. We always go from like broader view and help companies, businesses, organizations to change on a very ground level, change them from the inside, change, bring the change to the whole team. So it's not only, my boss decided we need to go green, so now we have those bins and that's enough. No, we always work with all teams, even from cleaners, starting from cleaners, finishing at financial department. So with whoever needs to feel and understand why this change is happening. We did many interesting projects in consulting. We had festivals, wherever it's music festival or like book festival. We had different businesses, governmental businesses or private businesses, receiving our services. And I'm happy to see that more and more companies are addressing us, because this work also, it's interesting, but it's also, you can measure the impact. You can see what changed in certain company or organization. And the third direction of a business is education. So we give out lectures. Some of them are for free, like people can just listen to them freely, openly. Some of them are paid if it's something specific or more like complicated. And so this is number three, right? My part of the business, but it was number one. But I see the change, like contribution that I can do. It's not only through lectures, through the shop or through consulting, but through all those things together. They're very intertwined and sometimes we jungle them and we lose control of what's important more, what's important less. But we try to do it by seeing the result and by feeling how good a company grows, how good it goes. And I think, well, I know that our business is very sustainable because even though quarantine hit Ukraine quite hard, we didn't need to fire anybody. We even grew a team a little bit. Our team is now 8 people together. And I'm happy to see that the company brings change through many platforms, like through our Instagram platform, which is very popular and usable in Ukraine. I even sometimes see people, I heard you're a shop, but I go to your page and it's like activism. And yes, that's actually, we don't sell things. We educate and people can make a choice whether they need something from a shop or whether they can make it on them on their own, or they can borrow it or buy it like used secondhand. Yeah, my speech was a little bit shorter, but I think time is gold. So I will finish on this for now and we'll be happy to see you in the rooms later.
Thank you so much, Anna. If I may, we still have 3 minutes of your time, and I know a bit of your personal story. So if I may ask you a question about your shift from work in air transportation company to your own business, how did that happen? Could you please use these 2 minutes for that?
Yeah, of course. So I'm 30, just in case you think I'm under 18. But I graduated from aviation university, and I was like aircraft engineer. And then I worked in aviation for 2.5 years in different directions. But the last one was I was cabin crew for 1.5 years working for Wizz Air. And then it was, I loved my job because I love people and I love helping people, but also was a bit painful because I saw that my ideas of how to change things are very forward looking, like on the aircraft, the space weight is very limited, and trying to persuade somebody to go reusable on the aircraft, tricky. So it wasn't the reason why I quit. I actually got just basically physically and mentally tired, and I think if you have a chance to work as a cabin crew, go and do it. It's really life-changing experience, but don't stick there too long. There's a lot of radiation and low cabin pressure, not good for your health. And but if you continue working, just drink a lot and be fit and use cups on board, reusable ones. Then after I quit Wizz Air, I had probably 2.5 years, as I think, doing nothing, but actually I did a lot of my own research and different little studies here and there. And actually in that period of time, I got to the landfill, and I had this free resource to invest my energy into something important. And I think all the coincidences turned to be really, really useful.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much to all the speakers for wonderful insights, and for such different insights, actually, and for such different stories that we can all take a look at and maybe find something similar or find something different, which actually can answer to us. So now, if I may ask you for us to have just 2 minutes of quiet time and think about what we've heard and think about anything that you would like to think about on the topic or not. Feel free to turn off your camera or keep it on. It's up to you. A few minutes in quiet time, and then we will come back and go to our breakout rooms. Thank you. you so much, everybody. I hope you had an opportunity to gather your thoughts. So now, thanks to our support, technical support, thank you very much. We now have three rooms with three different speakers and three different topics. The first room will be with Justine, and the topic will be on the work at the policy level, the work that Justine is doing and how you might be involved, but you feel free to discuss whatever you like with Justine. The second room will be with Jack. Jack will be mostly talking, and Jack is responsible for the work with municipalities and the municipality level. So please go ahead and join Jack in the room number two. And the third room will be with Anna, and Anna's emphasis will be on work with businesses. This is the time for us to leave the main room and join the breakout rooms. We will have 20 minutes. Go ahead, please have discussions with speakers. This is the time for you to speak up, and this is the time for you to ask any questions you have. We will have 20 minutes for that. And then please, after 20 minutes, come back to the main room. Thank you very much. Go ahead and join the rooms. Welcome back, dear participants. Welcome back, dear friends. I hope you've had an impactful and fruitful discussion, and I hope you've had a chance to get to know better our speakers, and you've got a chance to get to know more about the things that you were wondering. I'm sure that we could have spent hours in this conversation. Well, I usually can spend hours in these conversations, but we need to eat and sleep and walk for a while. So probably this is the time for us to be closing. But before we do that, we still have a few minutes left, and I would love to ask you whether you have any insights that you really wanted to share with the whole group. And if you do, please either put a star in chat and we will ask you, or raise your hand and we will also ask you. We will have just a few minutes for this. And afterwards, we might ask our speakers for any final thoughts they would like to share with the whole group. But it will be interesting to hear you about your insights, about your thoughts, about your possible next steps. As we agreed at the end of this half hour and a half, we are going to change the world. So maybe you have a plan for that already. All jokes aside, feel free to go ahead and share any thoughts you might have. Don't be shy. Who do we pick? Who do we pick? No, I'm just joking. Don't worry. If any of the speakers feel like they want to share some final thoughts or final insights, if they want to, please do so. I myself maybe just wanted to highlight a few things that I wrote down from our conversation and from the after the speaker's conversation. Conversations and stories. I see Anna is raising her hand. Yay. Go ahead, Anna. You can go first.
Great, thank you. It's actually going to be a conclusion plus partly an answer to the last question we could discuss in the room. I think the big change can be definitely done on combination of different levels, so governmental plus personal plus businesses. And we were talking about doing it in a nice way, in a marketing wise way, so that more people would get attracted to this idea and see it with benefits for themselves, for their business, for their organization. And those benefits, in every case, they need to be measured. And for business, most of the time, impact is money, finance. So our goal is to find that hole whereby changes save their money or bring the value to the company so they grow their profit. at the end of the day. This is the tricky way to change the world. And for non-governmental organization is to help them to increase the amount of people who are with them, increase their impact. Personal level, I don't know, it can be anything to whoever prefers what. I just like seeing changes and not shouting about them to the whole world, but to helping people here and there and inspiring them, because I believe every one of us have their own topic that inspires them, that is their own little star that guides them. And if with any of your actions or words can help person to develop their something that they love and they want to do, this is the only thing that matters. And in sustainability is endless amount of problems, so endless amount of solutions. I'm very thankful to be part of this. Give my word back to Jack.
All right, is that okay, Sophia?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Anna. Go ahead, Jack.
Yeah, sorry, that's a tough act to follow, Anna. Lovely words. Just very quickly, I think whether we're talking to businesses or policymakers or municipalities, you have to understand, I think for us, we are lucky. The environment is the most important thing. We sort of recognize and understand the challenges, but for others, it's not. And we need to adapt our messaging and speak their language. And so I think it's a key thing for us to identify motivations for whoever we're trying to speak with. It may be our long distance cousin who drinks only water from a plastic bottle, or it might be the deputy commission of the UN, of the European Union. I don't know, whoever we're speaking to, you need to understand, okay, why do they sort of follow the path that they are at the moment? What values do they hold important to them? And therefore, what would maybe make them change? Is it simply a convenience matter, or is it money, or is it health? All these sort of different concerns that we should factor in and therefore adapt to. So whether we're speaking to our friends, our politicians, or our businesses. And so, I just wanted to sort of highlight that. I think that's something interesting to end on. And yeah, thank you all for the discussions as well. It's been super interesting.
Thank you so much, Jack. We see Nick's hand. Please go ahead, Nick.
Yeah, thank you. I was in Anna's group, and she spoke really powerfully about the variety of things that her company does. I mean, it's she's an activist as well as being a business woman, and they've got expanded to about being about 8 people. They're also educators, and we were talking about how you balance all of those things out. And Anna was talking about how too few people had made it really difficult, and it had kind of spread them really thin. They got burnt out, and that was a real challenge. So I think I take out of what Anna was saying that you need to take self seriously. And she was talking about wanting to make the business side of what they do, and presumably the others as well, as attractive as possible. So she's putting forward a really powerful business solution that has an educative arm to it, that has a real kind of appeal to those people that want to become change makers. And all of those are wrapped up really nicely together. So there's something profound about taking yourself seriously, doing the work to actually put a really good, attractive product together that's going to immediately appeal to people that in the market. And I think those are really good principles that she put forward. So thank you, Anna.
Thank you so much, Nick. If there's anyone who would like to jump in, please do. If not, I would like to share some things that I've heard in private rooms, in breakout rooms, and as well after the conversations and discussions of our speakers. And in one of the rooms, I've heard such thought about being weird, and that it can be the environmental activists can be perceived as strange and not very and a bit weird and a bit strange. And I just wanted to say that it is something that is difficult to deal with, but there is always change with the consistency of your work and with the power of communication. As much as you bring your idea forward, along the way, you will get more and more people who will want to join. And it's not the matter of days, unfortunately, it's the matter of time, but it is a long shot and it's worth it. And another thought that I've heard and I really loved, it was from Anna about responsible consumption being logical. You know, it's only logical. And indeed, it is only logical because there is some disbalance we are facing at the moment that it's just we can use our resources wisely. And this is the best probably part of the environmental topic that I love, which it consists of two approaches, which is love, basically love towards what is around us and respect towards it. And this logical part, that it's logical to use it wisely. It's this logical approach actually shows in, it comes into our love and it comes from our day-to-day actions. And there is another thing, and I'm actually blabbing right now because nobody else is raising their hands, but there is one thing that I really, really wanted to highlight, which struck me the most and connected all of our speakers, how traveling and meeting other people is actually influencing us, and how sometimes we can underestimate some networking activities that we are joining and participating in. But from the stories of our people, and I can tell you for sure that this is my story as well, that getting out and see something else and have conversations with people who have just a little bit of a different perspective teaches you tremendously about what's important and what's not, and teaches you different way and different approach to our world and planet Earth. Yeah, I blabbed until almost the end, unfortunately. We are very close to the end. And thank you so much for everybody who joined. Thank you so much to our amazing speakers. Thank you so much for our amazing technical support. Thank you so much for the amazing organization who empowered this session. Thank you so much to our bards who are actually working really, really hard at the moment, but on the background. And I'm sure that we will bring the change as we deserve it. And yeah.
Thank you, Sophia.
Thank you, Irina. Give it back to you.
Yeah, thank you, Sophia, for running this, and thank you, dear speakers. And for all of you who are here, you should be on the mailing list, and we will be sending updates pretty much daily about different workshops that are happening throughout the next 10 days. So please stay on the lookout and join our different sessions on climate and security, on agroforestry, nature of solution, and innovation. So I hope to see you back here tomorrow and the following days. So stay tuned. Thank you.